does your electricity get to you? And whose dog is that? Can you imagine your life without electricity? Think about it. You wouldn't be watching this video without it. We don't give much thought into the energy we consume or where it comes from. So, we begin our journey today at one of Singapore's first power plants.
Risa, St. James Power Station, do you know this is one of the oldest power stations in Singapore?
But why aren't buildings like these in use anymore?
In the 1900s, coal was used for generating electricity because it was easily transportable. And then there was the oil boom, and we started using fuel oil in the 1960s. In fact, St. James Power Station was one of the first power stations to use fuel oil to generate electricity.
Oh, so we moved from coal to fuel oil. So what are we generating electricity from now?
Today, 95% of our electricity is generated from natural gas. And that switch came around the 1990s. It's much cleaner than coal and fuel oil, but also the process to generate from natural gas is more efficient, and therefore it is cheaper.
So what were some of the early concerns when it came to energy and electricity in Singapore?
You know, Risa, when we were independent in 1965, not every home had electricity. In fact, it was considered quite a luxury to have your home fully powered. My parents were telling me that when they were young, they were using kerosene lamps to study at night. So literally burning midnight oil. The government started a program to make sure that electricity was accessible, affordable, and later on as we progress as a nation, to have reliable supply of electricity.
Natural gas accounts for 95% of Singapore's electricity production. And it's at facilities like this where its journey from fuel to power begins. So where exactly are we and what's happening here?
So we're at Sembcorp's power plant in Jurong Island today. Here's where we actually import natural gas to produce electricity.
And where exactly are we? Because I guess I always imagined that a power plant would be like a singular building or several buildings, but there seems to be so many things happening around us.
This entire area comprises about 15 hectares, and the power plant isn't exactly just one centralized building. It actually is a compound that has a few parts to it. On the left, you'll see large tubes. These are actually bringing seawater for our cooling needs. We have boilers at the back, we have a gas turbine, we have a heat recovery steam generator. So there are a few parts that actually make up a power plant.
How much electricity is generated here?
So this is Sembcorp's first power plant. We established this over two decades ago. So we produce enough electricity here to meet maybe about 10% of Singapore's requirements or over a million households.
I see. So could you give us an overview of Sembcorp's operations and what is their role within Singapore's energy landscape?
So Sembcorp is a Singaporean energy company, and today we meet about 30% of Singapore's energy needs, and this is both gas as well as power. Right. Now, even though Singapore is home market, Sembcorp has its operations in over 10 countries globally. Sembcorp was the first importer of natural gas to Singapore. Together with its partners, built a 600-kilometer pipeline from Jurong Island all the way to the West Natuna Sea in Indonesia. That allowed us to import natural gas to Singapore.
And these pipes are under the sea?
Exactly.
Deep into the...
They sit on the seabed.
Oh, and 600 kilometres of that.
So for context, Singapore is about 50 kilometres wide.
So that's like more than 10 times of Singapore's length from east to west.
Exactly.
Wow. So if and when low-carbon fuel becomes more readily available, can it be supplied into the cogen power plant?
Sembcorp is currently building a new power plant. It's a 600-megawatt power plant. And that would be able to actually burn both natural gas and hydrogen. Hydrogen, if produced through sustainable means, would actually be a zero carbon fuel. And that would result in a product that would actually be much lower than the typical carbon emissions levels of a natural gas-based power plant.
Right, so it's a more sustainable option in a way.
Exactly.
Right. Natural gas is not a renewable fuel source, but it is a crucial component of Singapore's energy supply. However, renewable options like this floating solar farm are quickly growing.
We're at Sembcorp Tengeh's floating solar farm. Here we harness the sun's energy and turn it into electricity. Spanning across 45 hectares of the reservoir, we have about 122,000 panels generating electricity that could power approximately 16,000 HDB flats. And very importantly, it also helps us to avoid carbon emissions, about 31 kilotons of carbon emissions, and that is equivalent to removing 7,000 cars off the road.
Oh, 7,000, right. What is Sembcorp's role in Singapore's renewable energy development?
Sembcorp is Singapore's largest homegrown renewables player, and Sembcorp Solar is Singapore's largest solar developer. And we contribute more than 50% of Singapore's solar targets. We have a comprehensive portfolio of solar on rooftops, carports, land, as well as what you see today. And that's across more than 4,000 sites in Singapore.
So why floating solar farms instead of land-based solar farms?
Yeah, we have 17 reservoirs in Singapore. Yeah, so there is water bodies that we can put solar farm on. With floating solar farm, we have the opportunity to build it to scale, as well as benefit from the cool environment, yeah, with the water as well as the wind. That helps the solar farm to perform better than other farms.
Right. So do you see more solar farms in Singapore's renewable energy future?
Yes, certainly. As I mentioned earlier on, we have scarcity of land and rooftop space. So putting on water is a good alternative. In addition to this Tengeh solar farm, we are already developing two other solar farms, one in Pandan and one in Kanji.
Ah, I see. So where does all this energy go from here?
We are in the lift, it is very small, and we are going down really, really deep into the ground. And I'm very excited to see what's going to be there. Thank you. This is my breathing apparatus. In the event of an emergency, we will use the things inside to ensure that we have enough oxygen. This is kind of not what I imagined. I think I imagined a wider space, but it's still very interesting nonetheless. I see a lot of wires, very, very thick cables and wires.
So currently we are 60 meters below ground inside the cable tunnel in SP. Surrounding us are the extra high voltage cable, which is a part of the electricity transmission network.
Yep. So where is this in terms of the larger transmission of electricity from generators to our homes?
So basically this extra high voltage cable carries electricity supply from the power generation plant to our substation.
I see. So this is kind of in the middle between a generator and then the tunnels and then the substations.
Yes.
And then it goes to our homes.
Affirmative.
And why are they underground?
Actually, with all these cable tunnels being built, we can greatly reduce the supply interruptions. Example, like accidental damage by third-party contractors or environmental conditions.
So these tunnels are present across the whole island?
Yes, affirmative.
So they're actually just below us and we don't even know?
Yes, you're right.
How does the team maintain these tunnels and the cables?
So basically our team carry out routine maintenance check to look out for potential issues inside this tunnel. Example like the wear and tear, cracks and water seepages. However, in recent years, we have introduced SPOT, which is these robotic dogs, to our inspection teams. So basically these robotic dogs is equipped with cameras and thermal imaging capabilities, whereby it can navigate the tunnel on its own. So basically, with all these measures, it helps to improve the productivity of our team and also improve the grid reliability.
So with things like AI and electric vehicles that are all very energy demanding, is the grid ready for the future?
To manage this, SP uses digital twins. So basically, this digital twins is a virtual version of power grid. And this virtual power grid will help to predict and test the behavior of our grid before putting into real operations.
So you're able to try out different configurations on this virtual grid?
Yes, affirmative. With the increasing in the electricity demands, we need to understand how the grid will behave.
We've seen how electricity is produced at the generator, and then we just went to the tunnel, and now we're here in a substation. So what exactly is a substation?
So basically a substation is a building that houses transmission and distribution equipments for the redistribution of electricity to the household and the commercial buildings. So where we are now is the first large-scale underground substation in Southeast Asia.
So after it reaches here, what happens to the electricity? Because the voltage cannot be so high, right, when it's transmitted to households?
So within the substation itself, there will be a power transformer stepping down to lower voltage to 22 kV and further lower to 400 volts and 230 volts to be safe use for home appliances and office appliances. Prior to 1970s, Singapore operates at a lower voltage, which is around 66 kilovolts, and the increase in electricity demands. In the mid-1970s, we have increased to 230 volts. And as of now, we have further upgraded to 400 kilovolts.
It's been really insightful learning about how electricity flows from the generators to our homes. I think it's something that I've definitely taken for granted. You know, you just turn on the switch and you expect it to come on. This is really cool. So Ryan, we're in a room with many, many big screens behind us. So where exactly are we?
Yeah, so currently we're at SP Group's Electricity Distribution Control Center, or DCC for short. So here our primary role is to monitor and oversee over 12,000 substations across Singapore, which make up Singapore's electricity network.
And do you distribute electricity here?
No, that's a common misconception. We don't actually directly distribute the energy. What we do is that we facilitate the transfer of electricity.
So you're able to identify when a power outage happens from this room?
Yes, so when a disruption happens, what happens is that the information comes in through our screens and we use that information to determine the location of the outage. We isolate the fault and thereafter we try and restore supply.
Mm-hmm. If you are unable to do it here, then what happens after?
So if we're unable to restore supply from DCC, what happens is that we activate our electricity service response team, our standby officers, as well as our mobile generator teams down to site in order to do a site assessment to see how they're able to restore supply from the ground.
So you're kind of like first responders in
yes.
that sense?
Yes, we are. What we deal with here at DCC is a larger scale disruption. So this can potentially be caused by third-party contractors who might accidentally hit our power cables when they are doing excavation works to access the supply or the utilities cables underneath the ground.
I can imagine it can be really, really life or death in certain cases.
Yes, right? That's true. And there are some instances where we have very power-sensitive customers who need supply on at all times. So it is our duty to ensure that power supply can get back online as fast as possible.
Is the grid like maintained throughout the day?
Yes, our grid is maintained 24/7, rain or shine. Mm-hmm. So we have to ensure that our operators are on standby 24/7 to make sure that any disruptions can be caught promptly and attended to as quickly as possible. In 2024, on average, a customer in Singapore experienced only 14.2 seconds of supply interruption in the whole year.
Wow.
So that puts us as one of the highest rated power grids in the world.
So I've learned about natural gas and about solar energy. Are these going to be big parts in Singapore's future?
You know, when I talk about how we started our energy story when we first had independence, it was about making sure every home had access to electricity. Today we are concerned about ensuring that our electricity supply is sustainable, secure and affordable.
So how are we going about doing that then?
We call it the four switches strategy. Right? So the first switch, we'll continue to use natural gas, but we also want the clean energy. And that's where solar adoption is important. So we're going to put as many solar panels on our rooftops as possible. We are also thinking of how we can connect our grids with our neighbors so that we can import electricity from clean sources like hydropower and solar energy.
So we do import from others, but is it a two-way thing?
Yeah, so for example, we have a connection with Malaysia. It provides mutual support for the grids in times of emergencies or crisis. And the last switch is we're looking to low carbon alternatives in the future. So we're looking at geothermal and even studying nuclear.
Oh wow!
The importance of having the four switches means that we have a diversity of options. It's like a music mixer. Depending on how technology evolves, we adjust the sources accordingly.
Complex system that powers our lives every day. Often unseen, a network of people and expertise keeps our homes bright and our city alive.